Hi, nobody just yet. I'm just gonna wait a couple minutes to see if people are going to log on. I know that I live in just outside of Toronto, so I'm in Eastern Standard Time. So I know everyone over on the West Coast is probably still at work getting excited for their long weekend. These are always really nerve-wracking, even though I've done these a bunch of times, but I'm excited to talk tonight about some strategies for keeping performance high. Oh, I got one person. Hi. Strategies for keeping performance high while either in a cut or making weight for a meet, both kind of dieting, but just some strategies to make sure that you are feeling your best in the gym while working towards your goals. Otherwise, I think I'm just gonna get started. So, the four things that I'm going to kind of touch on tonight are I have my notes over here, sort of nutrient timing around your training, how to avoid macro hoarding, and why it's really important not to hoard your macros, especially when you're in a cut. Eating for volume, because as we know, when you're dieting, sometimes hunger is an issue. And if I tell you not to hoard your macros, you may say, Kate, that's crazy because I'm hungry at nighttime. And then some other factors to consider before kind of getting too concerned about your diet ruining your gains, which I think we all have had moments of being like, oh no, I'm starving, I can't do this. But there's lots of other things going on. So I'm going to highlight those for you too. And of course, as always, if you have any questions, please post them here. I will go back and review all the comments tonight, tomorrow, all through the weekend to make sure I follow up if you comment after I'm finished the live video. So, first of all, oftentimes, what will happen is people will have their sort of normal food schedule that they'll stick to, and then as the diet progresses, or you need to get a bit more assertive through your weight cut leading up to a meet, you might end up taking away the carbs near your training because ideally we want to be putting a good chunk of our carbs around training. And that way we don't have to worry about being hungry at breakfast or being hungry at night. But depending on when you train, that can end up sort of shooting you in the foot because the carbs around your training is what's going to keep your performance high. So, generally speaking, when we're talking about a good amount of carbs, that's going to mean approximately, 25 to 30% of your daily carbs. So, using myself as an example, I eat approximately 200 carbs a day. Before my training sessions, I like to get in about 50 carbs or so, just to make sure that I'm fueled up and ready to go. Again, all these sort of like numbers and hard figures are just examples, and every single person is going to be different. So of course, talk to your coach if you have any specific questions or concerns. So when you're looking at food choices, we want to make sure that that's when you're actually getting in dense sources of carbs. You don't want to be eating vegetables before you go train. You're probably going to feel bloated. You might feel sluggish. The other day, I didn't realize I was going to the gym at a certain time, and I ate like a giant bowl of cauliflower rice before going to deadlift. I didn't feel so good. So that's like another consideration, where obviously it wasn't my diet that made me have a poor training session, it was poor food selection. So thinking of things that you digest well, don't leave you bloated, aren't going to be too full. So things like banana, rice, oatmeal, other sorts of fruits. If you have like low appetite during training or you feel nauseous, sometimes like a watered down Gatorade would be a good option, just to kind of make sure you're getting in carbs in and around your training. Personally, I recommend eating around 45 minutes to an hour so that you have a lot of time to digest and it's not sitting at the top of your stomach. But again, it's completely personal. So that's kind of like the basic overall of that's what you want to be doing to make sure that you're fueling your training effectively. So you're hungry, you're in a diet. How do you make sure that you're eating that many carbs around training? Well, a lot of times what happens is that people end up macro hoarding in the evening, or there's a certain meal that they really like eating, a specific food. But as your carbs get lower, you need to be smarter about where you're placing your carbs. So for example, for breakfast, if you're eating like toast or oatmeal, I should clarify. Say if you're training like in the evening. So if you're not training in the morning, that's where you want to kind of be taking away some of your carbs to allow you to be fueled for later. So some ideas could be if you're eating oatmeal or toast or having a big high carb breakfast, switch it up and have something that is higher in volume, higher in fat, higher in protein. So you could do a omelet with tons of veggies. And I actually made a post in the Facebook group not too long ago showing one of my breakfasts. And when your coaches tell you to eat high volume, we're not talking about putting like a fistful of spinach on your plate. Like, we're talking like a couple hundred grams of vegetables per meal. So you're having like a really high volume plate of food so that you're satiated without taking in a lot of calories. Sorry, I'm just looking at my notes. So you could do some swaps. Do some swaps where you could add in some cauliflower to your oats in the morning. You could add in shredded zucchini. You could cut some of your bread out for like a high fiber tortilla, some rice cakes, things like that, just so that you're stretching the volume. We have a bunch of great blogs on this that I will link in the comment section in terms of eating for volume and some high volume food ideas. And then if you're training in the morning, again, we want to do this, but just kind of switched around and opposite. So you need to still get your carbs in the morning, but then through the day, focus on eating higher volume meals. So like salads, things like that for later in the day. So again, that you're still satiated. And again, one of the things that I'm sure you've all heard is that when you're making changes, it's going to be uncomfortable. So the first week after your macros get changed, you might be like, oh my gosh, I can't do this. I really love eating my Halo top at nighttime, or I really love eating this really big breakfast, or I have this treat that I have in the afternoon that I love. I can never give it up. Just be patient, give it a shot. And oftentimes those are just habits that we have. So if you remind yourself that making the small sacrifice is going to make you feel better in the gym. It's going to have you being able to push yourself harder in the gym, probably make better progress because you're able to train and recover. It's definitely worth it. So it's kind of about just choosing your priority. And if there's something that you super love that you don't really want to give up, it doesn't mean you have to give it up forever. But save it for a rest day. So if there's something that you really want to save your macros up for to treat yourself and work it into your day, just do it on a rest day so that you're able to still lay your macros out effectively during your training sessions. Okay, so this might actually be a short live video. So in terms of some other factors to consider when trying not to freak out about losing your gains during a cut is that as you kind of, especially if you're a competitor, as your training blocks kind of go week to week, you're probably building intensity. You're probably building either like your weights or volumes. So that's going to impact how you're feeling too. So if you're having a really rough week or like a rough day, take a look to make sure that it's not just accumulation of fatigue from your training. And if so, take some extra time to recover. A lot of times when we're feeling a little bit lower energy or aren't completely dialed in because we're tired or we're dieting, like those things do definitely add up. We can sometimes cut corners. So I know for me, if I'm dragging at the gym, I might cut my warm up a bit short. I might not spend the time to roll around as much as I normally would. I might not pay as much attention to my at-home mobility. So make sure that you're double checking that you're still committing to all the things that you know are going to keep you feeling well recovered. Hydration is a big one. I live in Canada and I've been basically like wearing this pillow sack of a dress for 3 days because it's the only way it can stay cool. So you want to be drinking probably about a gallon to a gallon and a half of water per day, and you need to be doing that consistently. So especially when you're dieting, like maybe you're not sitting down for mealtime as often, or you're tired and don't want to get up and fill your water bottle, make sure to have that with you so that you're consistently drinking water through the day. That will also help with hunger. So staying properly hydrated, oftentimes we can confuse hunger cues for, or like hunger cues that are actually thirst. So if you just drink some water, oftentimes it'll kind of help with that. That'll also help with recovery and feeling energized. That's basically all I have to say. But if you have any questions about like meals or how to place your carbs or absolutely anything else, I'm just gonna hang out for a little bit more. I'm probably gonna have some things that I forgot pop up too, but I always like to hear people's questions. I'm gonna drink some water. No questions. Okay. Some thumbs up. Thanks. That's basically it. I am going to post some blogs on some great, oh. Have I heard any good poems lately? No. George was one of my lovely members for a while that would always write me poems. So I haven't. So I am going to post some blogs about some high volume foods. We also did a really cool series a while ago of 100 calories in 100 different ways. So just to kind of give you some more perspective on what volume eating actually looks like. Ooh. And any advice for increasing water when you don't like water? Hashtag embarrassed. Well, Rebecca, I really don't like water. So no embarrassment here. So if you are comfortable with and respond to artificial sweeteners and you're fine, I use Mio like it's my day job. I also, when you're drinking water, don't just drink a little sip, like drink a couple chugs. So I will wake up in the morning, drink a glass of water, just plain, even though I don't really like it. And I carry a water bottle with me all the time to make sure that if I am thirsty, it's there, or I'm always like reminded to drink it. I also find drinking really cold water is helpful. It makes it slightly more palatable. So I'll make it icy. Other things too, you can include, like if you drink protein shakes, you can include that in your water intake. Herbal teas are really tasty too. Like I go to David's Tea and I'll get a bunch of fruity tea options and steep iced teas. So anything like that, you can definitely flavor it, or like lemon water, putting cucumber slices, mint, basil, anything like that makes it a little bit more exciting. But I need a Mio sponsorship. I go through that stuff pretty intensely. That's a good question. Hi, Mel. Okay, so I am going to sign off unless there are any. Oh. Yes, Mio's are the fruit punch is really good. Unless there are any more questions, and I will follow up on any other questions that come through, as well as post the blogs that I mentioned in my Facebook Live. So thanks, guys. It's always fun chatting to myself on these screens. But I hope you guys all have a wonderful long weekend if you are in the States. And that's it. Bye.